Good morning.
Good morning.
This morning I'm going to continue off. I'm reading in Luke chapter 1, little part of the Christmas story from the Message Bible. Luke chapter 1, verse 26, a virgin conceives. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to the Galilean village of Nazareth to a virgin engaged to be married to a man descended from David. His name was Joseph, and the virgin's name was Mary. Upon entering, Gabriel greeted her. "Good morning. You're beautiful with God's beauty, beautiful inside and out. God be with you." She was thoroughly shaken, wondering what was behind a greeting like that. I'd take a greeting like that. "Good morning. You are beautiful. You're beautiful with God's beauty, inside and out." She was shaken thoroughly, wondering what was behind such a greeting like that. But the angel assured her, "Mary, you have nothing to fear. God has a surprise for you. You will become pregnant and give birth to a son and call his name Jesus. He will be great. He will be called Son of the Highest. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. He will rule Jacob's house forever, no end ever to this kingdom." Mary said to the angel, "But how? I've never slept with a man." And the angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest hover over you. Therefore, the child you bring to birth will be called Holy, Son of God. And did you know that your cousin Elizabeth conceived a son, old as she is? Everyone called her barren, and here she is 6 months pregnant. Nothing, you see, is impossible with God." And Mary said, "Yes, I see it all now. I'm the Lord's maid, ready to serve. Let it be with me just as you say." Then the angel left her. Blessed among women, verse 39. Mary didn't waste a minute. She got up and traveled to a town in Judah in the hill country, straight to Zechariah's house, and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby in her womb leapt. She was filled with the Holy Spirit and sang out exuberantly, "You're so blessed among women, and the babe in your womb also blessed. And why am I so blessed that the mother of my Lord visits me? The moment the sound of your greeting entered my ears, the babe in my womb skipped like a lamb for sheer joy. Blessed woman who believed what God said, believe every word would come true." And Mary said, "I'm bursting with God news. I'm dancing the song of my Savior God. God took one good look at me, and look what happened. I'm the most fortunate woman on earth. What God has done for me will never be forgotten. The God whose very name is holy, set apart from all others. His mercy flows in wave after wave on those who are in awe before him. He bared his arm and showed his strength, scattered the bluffing braggarts. He knocked tyrants off their high horses and pulled victims out of the mud. The starving poor sat down to a banquet. The callous rich were left out in the cold. He embraced his chosen child, Israel. He remembered and piled on the mercies, piled them high. It's exactly what he promised, beginning with Abraham, right up to now." And Mary stayed with Elizabeth 3 months, and when they went back to her, before she went back to her own town. There's so much more to the Christmas story than just the birth of a baby. There's so much more to the story of the women who brought forth the good news. Elizabeth, who believed, and the good Lord had to shut her husband's mouth so he could believe. And then the babe in her womb. The minute Mary came in, Mary's attitude, Mary said, "Yes, yes, I believe that you can do what you've promised." And then what was the first thing Mary did? She went to someone who she knew she could believe with. She went to Elizabeth, who was also being blessed, so that together they could believe. So many times we take our good news and we share it with people who steal a little bit of that belief, who poo-poo our faith, who don't understand how we can be so excited about something so absurd that just doesn't even seem like it could possibly happen. But we know in our hearts that God has given us promises that will come to pass. So let us take the good news to each other, to people who will believe with us, to people who will rejoice with us, and let our response be to worship and praise God and to see God and to see ourselves as God sees us. Mary saw herself as God saw her. She said, God took a good look at me, and I get it. He chose me because he came and he did it, right? She knew it wasn't her. She couldn't make herself become pregnant. We can't make ourselves be better. We can't make ourselves become this new creation. But when the Holy Spirit comes and when God knocks on the door, we said yes. We said yes, and then the Holy Spirit came and did the same thing in us that it did with Mary. It took something that was impossible. It took a sinful nature, and it cast it aside and placed in us, in our hearts, a new creature. The Holy Spirit and our spirits become one, pure and acceptable in God's sight. And he looks at you and says, you're beautiful. You're beautiful with my beauty. He sees himself in you. And when we view each other through God's eyes, we see nothing but beauty. And so as we enter this Christmas season, let's choose to see the beauty. Let's choose to see the God beauty in all of us and all of the ones around us. And let's be bold and let's share the good news. And some may poo-poo it, and some may not, but we never know. We never know how long it will take for the words spoken to bear fruit. I know that there were years and years of my life when there was just that little tug, but I wasn't ready. There was, you know, Christmas. I always loved Christmas and I always loved Easter, but I wasn't in with both feet. You know, I knew growing up. I had that foundation growing up, going to Sunday school and learning, and but I just didn't get it. It wasn't mine yet. But people didn't give up on me. And it took a woman that I worked with who talked to me. I asked her about her church. I was a mom, and I wanted to take my son to church. And she said, I don't want to tell you about my church. I want to tell you about Jesus. And my life changed. So don't give up. Share Jesus. Yes. You just never know. Amen. In Jesus' name. That's right. I miss Darlene. Christmas is hard without her for me. Anybody have any prayer requests or testimonies this morning? Yeah, Roberto.
Yesterday afternoon at about 6:30, and my mother-in-law called me. She was talking about how she just passed away. And then she said, and I remember I had no kid. About 2 weeks ago, I felt really strong in my spirit that God was going to be my past. there's an increase. There's more responsibility coming upon this body of believers. And I know there are prayer warriors that are missed, but I'm going to just let the Lord call them. And I'm also going to let them be called from the north, south, and the east, and the west, because there are principalities and things of this region that need to be coming down. And I believe we're here for such a time as this to take care of the situation.
Amen.
It's not by accident that people are gone because of sickness and things like that. This is part of warfare that is going on right now. So I pray for the warriors to rise up. I pray that the fullness of this body be complete. When we read the word here in a minute that talks about the body, it's not talking only about our own personal body, but the body of this church, this group, this gathering, this fellowship, that the Lord is strengthening and getting prepared for a season that is coming very shortly.
Yeah, Myron. Praise the Lord. Yeah, Don.
Last weekend, 15 family members went deer hunting, and we had a wonderful time. But all kind of, we haven't done that as a group for several years. But Jane and I went to a wedding of a cousin in Iowa City.
How it all happened.
And I ran into my cousin before we went deer hunting, and she had her knee and she was having all kinds of trouble with it. So anyhow, I told her, I said, well, her name's Janie too. And I said, Janie, she's just almost totally recovered. And I said, well, that's great. Well, that was just the beginning. That night, we stayed in a little town called Memphis, Missouri. stayed in a little hotel there, because that's the closest hotel to where we were. And, oh, man, we had adjoining rooms. And we had a hoedown. I'll tell you this, you know, you ever go into a hotel room and you just get a creepy feeling like, what has happened in this room? Well, I guarantee you, there's people going to go into that room and say, I mean, how God permeated into those walls. We had little kids, Abram, one of them, that had not seen that kind of. We just got going and playing music. Of course, everybody's got on their iPhones. Andy, I don't know how many songs he had, but it just kept building, more intense. Everybody was getting into it. What an opportunity to tell these young people that this Jesus that we serve is real.
Yes.
And I always fall back to James Healy because I know exactly how Abraham felt when Jesus said, he longed to see my day, saw it, and rejoiced in it. I looked up that word rejoice. And I mean, it was beyond being happy.
Yes.
He literally jumped up and down to
exultant
see that
joy.
He was so thrilled to know that, and I'm sure the Lord told him that, Abraham, down to your seed, I am going to come into the earth.
Yeah.
I am going to redeem people. And so Abraham was just beside himself. Well, that's the way we felt when Jane was delivered. And I tell that story because, he didn't do it just for us. It's just that we dared to believe he would do it.
Yes.
He's the same. And I tell people over and over and over, and I got to thinking about it sitting here this morning. You know, we're sowing seed without even realizing it. I mean, telling people, strangers, what happened, that this Jesus, and I said, if he doesn't heal today, just like he did 2,000 years ago, then he never did.
No.
You better grasp it. The Jesus that you went to Sunday school and heard about, and now you put on a back shelf, like, well, that, you know, that's not really. No, he's just the same.
Mm-hmm.
If anybody's changed, we all have.
Yes, amen.
But I'm telling you what, you don't have to be in church to have church.
That's true.
And people, I don't know what they thought, the people, we were loud. But you know what? Nobody complained.
Praise the Lord.
And we came through Albia, Iowa. I about fainted. A nativity, an entire nativity scene on the courthouse lawn.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
And I told Jane, I said, well, you know what it told me? Nobody in Albia complained.
Yeah.
Yep.
They all accepted that as that's what Christmas is all about.
Amen.
Thank the Lord.
Anyhow.
Praise the Lord. Well, when you were speaking, the scripture that talks about the reapers will overtake the sowers, there still has to be somebody to sow. And we just never know. All this fruit, the seed has to bear fruit. It's just when. And so just keep sowing, like you said, just keep sowing.
You know, all he really asked us to do is to introduce Jesus.
Yep.
That's the sowing. And Paul said, you know, somebody else waters, God gives the increase. So we may never see what we have sown. We may never see the results, but we sow in faith.
Yes.
That's what he said to do. Therefore, it's up to him to give the increase.
Yes.
So many people take it as rejection. So, well, I witnessed this person and they didn't want to. Oh, no.
No.
It may take years, but that seed was sown.
That's right.
That's all we have to do. Introduce them to Jesus.
Yeah.
And tell people that Christianity is not a religion. It's
no,
a relationship.
Absolutely.
Everyone
absolutely.
Has an individual relationship with Jesus Christ.
That's right.
That's the difference.
Yeah. I get asked a lot what religion I am. And I said, religion is, I'm not. I don't believe in religion. I think a religion is from the enemy. But I'm a follower and a believer in Jesus Christ. And if you want, I'll tell you all about him. But yeah, no, it's so true. Religion. Yeah, I won't go there, but yes, religion is about God, and we serve God, and we are one with God. We have a return relationship with him. Amen. Sheila. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Glad you're here. Well, thank you. You're well. Yes. Yeah, Mike. So Wednesday there was a spirit of laughter in the house. Today, I just want to bawl. I want to cry. I don't know who is hurting, but there are heavy hearts in here today, and I feel your pain. And I don't know what's going on, but God knows. And he hears your heart, and he hears the cry of your heart. And so I don't know what's going on. I don't know who it is, but be encouraged that you are, God hears your prayers. He cares for you. I don't even know, but I can't get past it. I can't think up here. I don't know what's going on. I just can't go another minute without saying something. God has met your need, whatever it is. If you're tired, if you're hurting, if you're scared, God has met that need. And he wants you to just believe him and trust in him. He is our comforter. He is our friend. And he is our savior. And that means that we have been saved in every possible way. In every possible way. And not just us. The promises are not just for us, but they're for us in our house. So whatever's going on, God has heard your cries and has met those needs in Jesus' name. Yes. Right.
Don't look at the situation for whatever it looks like, but know this, that most assuredly he will do what he said he would do.
Yes.
And, you know, that could go, I realize that can go for all of us, but you're right, because
I felt
when I got here, someone is looking for reaching out.
Yes. I'm here.
More than able to meet your needs.
Yes.
So tell the devil he's a liar.
That's right.
And Jesus is the answer for everything.
Yes.
That's right.
And you are not alone. You are not alone. Whatever is happening, we are all praying for you in faith in Jesus' name. All right, well, let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, we just thank you that your love, that your love surpasses our own understanding, Lord, that your grace and your mercy are so beyond what we can even think or ask. Lord, we just ask that those that can't be here today, those that are hurting, Lord, those that are dealing with other situations, Lord, sickness or whatever, Lord, every member of this body, Lord, it's your provision, Lord, your protection, Lord. Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that you always encourage us, Lord, when our heads need lifted, Lord, that you bear the burden for us, Lord, that we do not have to carry these things alone, Lord, that we can come to you at any moment and ask and lay it at your feet and know that it is finished, Lord, that you go before us and you make the way, Lord. That there is nothing that is impossible with you, Lord. Lord, that you can come. You chose to robe yourself in flesh through the Virgin Mary, Lord, who knew no man, but she said yes to you. And you did something that you'd never done before. Jesus, come and do something again. We say yes to you, Lord. Let your spirit have its way within us, Lord, to lead us and guide us, Lord. Let us step out in faith and understand, casting aside our own imaginations, our own attempt to understand what you're doing, Lord, just to believe, to speak the words of faith, Lord, and to speak out what you would have us do and say, Lord. That you guide and direct our footsteps, Lord, to those that need to hear about who you are, about how you came to save them, Lord. Jesus, let us introduce those that are hungry and thirsty to the living water and the bread of life. Jesus, for so many this season is hurtful and hopeless. Where all the world rejoices, there are those that struggle, that hurt, that miss those that have gone on. Jesus, open our eyes to see, open our ears to hear, and open our mouths to speak words of encouragement and comfort to those that are hungry and seeking, Lord. And we'd ask as we enter this season, Lord, oh, Oh, with thankful hearts, Lord, knowing that you have finished. You have finished all the work that needs to be done, that every answer is already there. We just believe and trust in you, Lord, knowing that you are faithful, that you will never leave us, you will never forsake us. You always lead us and guide us into victory if we will just believe. Lord, and to look around, and when we need someone to rejoice with, when we need someone to help us believe, that we find those in our lives who can encourage us, Lord, who we can worship together and thank you together, Lord. Lord, that every time we come together in this house, in Abundant Life, Lord, that we rejoice together and we thank you for the blessings, Lord, for the, oh, Jesus, you're so good. You are miraculous. Let us not be shocked when you do miraculous things in our lives, but let us be thankful. Jesus, be with every person here today, Lord. Let our hearts and our minds be transformed from glory to glory, from glory to glory in your name, Jesus.
Hallelujah. There is a peace that is broken down every wall. He is a peace. He is a peace.
Hallelujah. I love you, Lord.
He is a peace who has broken down every wall.
That you are joyous. Is moving, and I don't want to just go through the announcements if there's something that God wants to do. So please, if you feel a word, if you need to pray for somebody, I don't want to just do church today. Something's going on, and God is going to have his way, so we'll continue with the service, but please be encouraged to follow as the Spirit leads. We have the calendar. I think we're good through the end of the year, but we'll get a 2015 calendar for anybody that wants to help with the children's ministry. And after the service today, there's going to be a soup supper. So please stay and join us for some fellowship and some really good food after the service today. All right, let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Yes, Lord. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Lord. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. All right. John and Don, would you two please come take the offering this morning? You sat in the special seats. Don, you want to ask the blessing?
Whoever had that back situation, I believe, is being healed right now, because from walking back up there and going through the time right now, I don't feel what I was feeling at all right now. Somebody been healed? Somebody been healed?
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, brother. Hallelujah. So let's proclaim who he is.
Yes.
He is the victor over all. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Hallelujah.
1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3.
Of the age when the earth you reclaim, you will gather the nations before you, and the eyes of all men will be fixed on the Lamb who was crucified. For with wisdom and mercy and justice you reign at your Father's side, and the angels will cry, Hail to the Lamb. Of all kings and the Lord of all lords.
Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord.
You're the Lion of Judah, the Lamb that was slain. You ascended to heaven and evermore will reign. At the end of the age when the earth you reclaim, you will gather the nations before you. The eyes of all men will be fixed on the Lamb who was crucified. For with wisdom and mercy and justice you reign at your Father's side, and the angels will cry, Hail to the Lamb who was slain for the world. Shall reign as the King shield in our hand and a sword at our side. There's a fire in our spirits that cannot be denied. As the Father has told us, for these you have died. For the nations that gathered before you. And the ears of all men need to hear of the Lamb who was crucified. Who descended from heaven yet was raised up to reign at your Father's side. And the angels will cry, Hail to the Lamb who was slain for the world. All kings and the Lord of all lords, as the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords, as the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords.
Our King. Worthy are you, Lord, to be worshiped and glorified and magnified, Lord. We give it all to you, Lord Jesus. Glory, 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 glory. Glory, 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 glory.
glory, 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 Lord. Glory, glory, glory. Just cry out to the Lord, love on Him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Praise, holy, great is your goodness? How great is your kindness? How great is your mercy to me? How great are your wonders? How great is your power? How great is your favor to me? And I'll sing of all your goodness, all your loving kindness, celebrate your faithfulness to me. I live here in your presence, live to give you reverence, celebrate your faithfulness to me. How great is your wisdom, how great is your freedom, your loving kindness, celebrate your faithfulness to me. I live here in your presence, here to give you reverence, celebrate your faithfulness to me.
If you are faithful, God, you will never change. Celebrate your name, celebrate your name.
You are faithful.
You are faithful, God. You will never change, and I will celebrate your name, celebrate your name.
I'll
sing of all your goodness, all your loving kindness, celebrate your faithfulness to me. I live here in your presence, here to give you reverence, celebrate your faithfulness to me.
How great is your goodness, how great is your kindness, how great is your mercy.
Hallelujah. Those of you that know me know I'm not one to say God said or God told me this and unless I really feel. But I felt like this morning the Lord said, because you're here, because you praised me, because you came with thanksgiving, what I have already done, you will see the manifestation in 7 days, within 7 days. Seven is God's number. It's the perfect number of God. And I believe there's people here today that have been praying about things, struggling with issues, relationships, health issues, finances, whatever it might be, that you've been crying out to God about. God's saying, you will see my hand move in your life and in your situation and circumstance within 7 days. I think we ought to just praise him right now.
Hallelujah.
It's done in Jesus' name. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated. God bless everybody. I appreciate everybody's testimonies and sharing with us this morning. You can see why it's so important that the body of Christ opens its mouth and speaks. That gives glory to God. It encourages those that are around you. And it witnesses the Holy Spirit. Because if you were listening here this morning, you heard so many of the testimonies, so many of the things that were spoken, all agree that it all somehow comes together when it's the Holy Spirit. And that's because the same Spirit that's in you is in me, is in you, and you, and you. And that Spirit is always in agreement. Though we externally may have differences from time to time, the Spirit is never at odds. Amen. He's always one. Praise God. So, amen. Sunday school kids, you can be dismissed. I hope everybody that's here will stay and have some soup and whatever else we have down there. Just hang out, fellowship, and encourage one another. Amen. And get a good meal. Hallelujah. That's a good thing. That's what the disciples used to do, it said. You know, they broke bread together and shared their faith. Praise God. So that's what we do. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thanks again, everybody, for being here this morning. And hallelujah. Somebody just had a witness. Praise the Lord. I want to talk to you this morning about the Holy Spirit, something God's been dealing with me about. And I suspect all of us have questions, you know, coming from different quote-unquote religious backgrounds or spiritual teachings and denominations and what have you. It's okay. It's all good wherever you're from. Amen. It's just the thing we all can't agree on for sure is Jesus is the way, the truth, and the light. And although we may deviate in some other areas, we can all live with that, or we can at least try to, praise the Lord. But I know I talk to different people, and even in my own mind, I suppose, we question sometimes what the actual work of the Holy Spirit is or how he works. And I think there's kind of like two camps, and I suppose there's plenty of things in between. But in one way, we think that, you know, the Holy Spirit just does everything, and then we kind of come in like the last inning pitcher and just do cleanup. You know, like the Holy Spirit's out there doing everything, and then we just pop in at the last minute and say something, and bang, you know, somebody's saved, somebody's healed, somebody's delivered, or whatever. Or we kind of are in the other mindset where we feel like it's what we're doing all this stuff, and then the Holy Spirit kind of comes in and does cleanup. He kind of puts his stamp of approval on it, and then that makes everything work. Well, I think it's really neither one. Maybe it's both and it's neither. But that's what I want to talk about this morning. I want us to look at things a little bit differently, and that's what we try to do, not just to be different, but to see what it is the Scripture is really saying to us. Because our whole purpose in being here is to do the same thing Jesus did. The reason we were born again, born righteous the way Jesus was born the first time, is so that we can do the same thing he did, and that is to reveal the Father. That is to bring people into relationship with God. And how do we do that? That's, I guess, the big question. And through the years, we've tried a lot of things, and It's all good because we're trying to do what we think we're supposed to be doing. But I want us to look at this and see what Jesus did and recognize then that's what we're supposed to be doing. And when I say that, I don't mean because Jesus was perfect. Now, remember, when Jesus was born into this world, he was born without sin. Right? He had no sin, but he was every bit a human being. He dealt with all the same uncomfortableness of being a human. He got sick. He had to go to the bathroom. He got tired. He got hungry. He cried at people's deaths. He wept over John the Baptist, over Lazarus, over people's hurting, and so on and so forth. He went through all that. He had pain. He hit himself with a hammer and probably and he dealt with that. And he fell and skinned his knee when he was a kid. And he did all the things that we don't really think about, but he did all that. He did the same stuff we do. He felt the same awkwardness of being a human and all that you have to deal with being a human. But he was without sin. Now, when we got born again, when you believed in him and you were born again, you were born without sin. You were born from above, the same way, in fact, that Jesus was born, by the Spirit of God, right? So now you are without sin. Now, I'm not saying you don't sin. I'm saying God sees you as totally innocent, just like Jesus, just like before there was a law, because now you're no longer under the law. Before there was a law, you couldn't be held accountable to the law, could you? Well, once you've been born again, you're no longer under the law. You have been saved by grace. So we can do what Jesus did. That's why he said, greater works will you do because I go to my Father. Otherwise, I'm sending back the Holy Spirit. It was already spoken here this morning. Roberto was talking about it from John 14. So that's where I want to go. But let's not do religion. Let's really do Jesus. I mean, let's understand what that is, because that's the way the Holy Spirit works. The Holy Spirit doesn't come to put a stamp of approval on our religion. The Holy Spirit comes to witness to the presence of Christ, to the reality of God, right? So that's what our responsibility is, if you can call it that, in representing God, in being a part of the body of Christ. Amen? In fact, wherever you are is where the body of Christ is, individually as well as collectively. We come together here as a body, but we are bodies individual as well, right? So let's begin with John chapter 16, and we'll read verses 7 through 17, Sheila. A little longer portion of scripture than we usually read, but to get everything in context before we get too far down the road here this morning. So John chapter 16, and we'll read verses 7 through 17. Okay, now this is Jesus is speaking, and he says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. And when he has come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin, because they believe not on me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and ye see me no more. Of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged. I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine. Therefore said I, that he shall take of mine, and shall show it unto you. A little while, and ye shall not see me, and again a little while, and ye shall see me, because I go to the Father. Then said some of his disciples among themselves, what is this that he saith unto us? A little while, and ye shall not see me, and again a little while, and ye shall see me, because I go to the Father. Now, Jesus must have known that they weren't going to be able to comprehend what the Holy Spirit was going to do in them. So later he told them to stay in Jerusalem and wait for the Holy Spirit. Because it was obvious they didn't get it. They didn't know exactly what it was he was talking about, this Holy Spirit. So let's look at Acts chapter 2, verses 2 through 4. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it set upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now let's skip down to verse 36, and we'll read 36 through 41. Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made the same Jesus whom ye have crucified both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, and they said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, Men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, Repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, Save yourselves from this untoward generation. Then they that gladly received his word, or believed, were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. Praise the Lord. So in John chapter 16, they didn't understand why it was better that Jesus left them. But then in Acts chapter 2, they experienced the power of the Holy Spirit. Right? That's what we just read. But what did they learn? That's the issue here. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 27. To whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's what they learned between John 16 and Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2 was a revelation of this Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now in John, let's go back to John chapter 16 and verse 8, if you will, Sheila. In John chapter 16, verse 8, Jesus said the Holy Spirit is going to prove the world to be in the wrong about sin, about righteousness, and about judgment. That's what that word reprove means. He says the Holy Spirit is going to come and prove that they're wrong about all of this. When he's come, he will reprove the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. He's gonna come, and he's going to prove that the world is wrong about these issues. But how's he going to do it is the question. He's going to do it by how we live the truth in front of the world. Praise the Lord. Jesus said, I'm going away, but I'll return. For a while, you're not going to see me, but then you're going to see me. He wasn't talking about the resurrection. He was talking about us. He was talking about the church. He was talking about what's going to happen after Acts chapter 2. Jesus would be seen. The truth would be known, but it would be known through us. Not what so much what we say as what we do. See, the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of Jesus. That's why it says, baptize in the name of Jesus. I'm not going to get into that debate this morning. I'm just saying that's what he's talking about. And just like the man Jesus, he wasn't overly freaked out about our behavior, about our sins, period. Now that goes against the grain when it comes to religion, but I'm telling you the way Jesus operated is the same way the Holy Spirit operates, or it's a different spirit. And the Holy Spirit is just like Jesus was, in that he is not really freaked out about our sins. The Holy Spirit is deeply interested in our sin. And it's the same way with the world. Sins are the things that come short of God, according to the Scripture. But sin is the condition of our unbelief. That's the issue the Holy Spirit has, not with the negative things we do or don't do, but the sin that keeps us from God, the sin of unbelief. Praise the Lord. So in John chapter 16, he talks about sin. Let's look at verse 9, Sheila. Of sin because they believe not on me. That's the issue that the Holy Spirit has, the same one that Jesus had, right? So then God, based on this, God is much more interested in the issue of unbelief than he is in behavior. Say praise the Lord. Somebody, praise the Lord. I don't care what you think. I don't care what you believed in terms of that. Let's look at what the Bible says and go by that. Let's quit trying to fit our theology into some narrow little way of thinking when that isn't the way God was operating. And I'll show you before we're through here this morning that it's not the sins that God has a problem with. He can take care of them and has taken care of them. It's the sin that's the issue here. The sins of the world are not the problem. For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that they who were in their sins might get over the sin. Praise God. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 1, and we'll look at verses 7 through 13. And connect that with John 16. So in Ephesians 1, chapter 7, he begins this with, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted or believed in Christ, in whom ye also trusted or believed, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Everybody say praise the Lord. We're sealed. You can't unseal it. You can't get out of it. God has sealed you, amen, in this family of God because of your belief, because of your faith, because you have trusted in Christ, right? Now, when you connect this with John chapter 16, the Holy Spirit makes us righteous, right? We're not making ourselves. You can't do anything to be righteous. The best things you can do are still filthy as far as God is concerned. Only God can make you righteous. Only the Holy Spirit can make you righteous. So he has made us righteous, and as we live our lives from that righteous position, not from good works, not from perfect behavior, but from the position of who we are in Christ. Amen. The righteousness of God in Christ. Amen. From that position, amen, among others. Not among other positions, but among other people. Praise the Lord. Without judgment. In other words, I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I live my life based on that truth. And the way that I do that is by not judging the people that are around me. Because I have no right to a sense of hierarchy or I'm better than they are or anything. It's by God. It's by his blood, by his finished work that I'm declared righteous. So it's idiotic of me, not to mention unscriptural and unspiritual, for me to be judgmental of some other person just because they haven't believed yet. Because that's the only difference. Right? Amen. And that's the only way that people will come face to face with the main issue, which is their belief, not their behavior. Are you with me? Praise the Lord. So as I live my life from the position of righteousness, not from a position of you know, better than you, holier than thou, more, you know, loved by God, but just simply from the position that I know that Jesus paid the price for my sins, and now I am the righteousness of God, and I'm not going to judge you, I'm not going to criticize you, I'm not going to beat you up, I'm going to live my life free, happy, celebrating what Christ has done for me. And when you come face to face with that, what does it do? Instead of me saying, quit doing that, quit doing this, quit having those, quit having this, by me just being happy, by me being fulfilled and me finding peace in this crazy world, they look at that, come face to face with that reality of what God has done in me, and they go, can that be for me too? Could I have that same thing? You know, forget about all the stuff you're doing. I'm just talking about God has done this. They come face to face with the main issue. What is the main issue? They don't believe. Look at John 16 and verse 13 this time. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. So Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Right? They that worship the Father, got to worship him in spirit and in truth. Now, he tells us when the Spirit of truth comes, that's the Spirit of Christ, because he, Christ is truth, he comes as truth, he'll come and he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he'll show you things to come. Now, all of us, we got to be honest, all of us are learning to believe Jesus, or to believe the truth in every area of our lives. Right? I mean, you might have believed and you got a financial breakthrough, but you're struggling with believing for healing. Right? Or maybe you got that down and that's worked for you and you've had some success there, but you're having trouble believing for relationships to be restored. Right? All of us got areas, you know, where maybe we're stronger in some areas. Our faith or our belief in certain things are greater than they are in other things. But they're all the truth. They're all what Jesus has declared. Go through here and find all the promises. Some of them we go, yes, hallelujah. Why? Because maybe we've had an experience already there, and it has given us greater faith to believe, not only for ourselves, but for others. But there's other areas where we've struggled and haven't really seen manifestation, and therefore we're still trying to figure out how to believe in that particular thing, for that particular thing, right? Well, this is what the Holy Spirit does, is he's going to lead us into all truth, to where we can believe for everything, all that Jesus has done, every promise that God has made, all the truth of Christ, the finished work of the cross. Amen? So, since none of us have total belief in every aspect, if we're honest, then we can invite others into learning how to believe. Are you understanding what I'm saying? We may think, I'm a believer, and they're not a believer. But the truth is, I'm a believer, but not a perfect believer. I'm still learning to believe, and that is how we help them who don't believe to believe. That's what the Holy Spirit does. I don't care what the religions do or what religious people do. I want to know what the Holy Spirit's doing, because that's the only thing that's going to work. Praise the Lord. So, We are helping them by our learning to believe, being honest, helps them to learn how to believe. That's the Holy Spirit. Instead of religion, which is judging others for their unbelief. You know, they're unbelievers, they're pagans, forget about it. They're heathens. Well, we are in some areas, you could say the same thing about us if it's just about believing, right? The sin that God is trying to give us total victory in. The only sin that God really is interested in is unbelief, because it keeps us from the total truth. It keeps us from all that God is. We've talked about it here this morning. And even if you didn't testify about it, we all know in our deepest, darkest, most frightening times, there's issues. We wonder, yes, I believe, but help my unbelief. We're like the guy, you know, that knows what it says, but I just haven't experienced it, and I'm struggling with this belief. Yes, I believe I'm saved. I got it, but I'm having a problem with this healing thing. You know, I'm having a problem with this finance because the bills just keep coming, and I'm not seeing the answer, and blah, 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 blah. That is the sin that God's concerned about, because it keeps us from totally identifying with Him, from totally being dependent on Him and totally trusting in Him and understanding truth. He wants to lead us into all truth, not just the truth that you're born again by the blood of Jesus, by His death, burial, and resurrection, but what other truth comes with that? By His stripes you were healed. He became poor that you might become rich. Whatever you set to your hand to prospers. All of the things that Jesus did to provide the victory for us. Amen. Look at John chapter 5 and verse 22. And we're just looking exactly what the Holy Spirit is trying to lead us to do. And we've jumped ahead of Him and tried to do all sorts of things, thinking that, well, if a little bit's good, we're just like the Jew. Well, you know, if it's a bad thing to work on the Sabbath, then what's work? You know, if it's bad to, you know, walk a mile, then it'd probably be really good if you didn't walk at all, wouldn't it? I mean, if you didn't walk more than a mile, that's okay. How about if I only walk a half a mile? Now, I'm even better than the guy that walked the mile. He didn't break the law, but he just didn't really, you know, really do God any favors. And that's kind of the way our attitudes can become. But He says that the Father, look at this. The Father judges no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son. Right? Now, God, He cannot lie. And the reason for that is God has poured out all of His wrath, all of His judgment on Jesus. So, the Father doesn't judge men. He has committed the judgment to His Son because He's the one that has the right to do it, since He paid the price. All right? Then look at John chapter 3. And verse 17. I don't care what some preacher or some well-meaning religious zealot is telling you about this is the judgment of God, that's the judgment of God. They're wrong. They're just wrong because it's not biblical. For God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. Jesus didn't come here to condemn. He didn't come to judge. He came to save. Now, it would be a good idea then, if we're going to be like Jesus, if we're going to be the body of Christ, if we're going to operate the way the Spirit of Jesus operates, that we don't want to be condemning, that we don't want to be judging, because God's not doing either one. Praise the Lord. In other words, Jesus has the right to judge and to condemn. He has every right to do it. But He came to do the opposite. The woman caught in the act of adultery. Look at John chapter 8, verses 10 and 11. Most of y'all know these, because we talk about these things all the time. We quote these scriptures, but let's just look at it for a moment. Now, this woman had been caught in the act of adultery, right? And they brought her out before Jesus, and they said, the law of Moses says that she's to be stoned to death. And so Jesus looks around all these religious people that are there, and He said, okay, whoever's here without any sin, you cast the first stone. Well, they all slink off because there wasn't anybody there without sin. And, of course, He knew that. The only one there without sin was Jesus. And here's what Jesus said. When Jesus lifted up Himself and saw none but the woman, He said unto her, woman, where are those thine accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? And she said, no man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Now, here's the reality. Here's the truism. Here's the truth that we need to see in Jesus' life. The less judgmental we are, the less judgmental we are, the more others experience what we have called conviction. Now, it sounds like an oxymoron, it sounds like it's a contradiction, but it's not. This is what Jesus did. This is how Jesus did it. So the less judgmental we are, the more the people around us are convicted. The more we judge, the less they're convicted. Let them judge themselves. The woman that was caught in an act of adultery knew that her lifestyle created the situation she was in. She knew that. She wasn't an idiot. Levi, the tax collector, he knew that his cheating and ripping people off and taking advantage of them caused them to hate him. He knew why he was hated. It didn't come as some great revelation that somebody had to come and tell him, hey, you know, you're cheating these people out of their money, you're backstabbing them, you're taking advantage of them, and that's why they hate you. He knew it. The rich young ruler, he knew deep down in his heart, he understood that he didn't have the answer for his own spiritual hunger. What do I got to do to be saved? You know, I mean, he knew he didn't have the answers. It was there. It was within himself. Jesus didn't have to aggressively confront them. He just had to be there to help them see why life wasn't working out for them. I heard Tim say this morning, talking about this young lady, that she's realizing that her choices have created situations and circumstances. Now, it wasn't like what, she was just stupid and then all of a sudden she got smart? No, she must have backed away from the situation a little bit and looked at it and thought, this mess is my mess and I got to take responsibility for it. Not that I can fix it, but I got to be accountable for my choices. I have something to say about what's going on in this messed up life of mine. That's what the Holy Spirit does. And he doesn't do it by beating them over the head with their bad behavior, because they already know they're bad. What he does is bring them non-judgment, love, compassion, concern, and it causes them to reevaluate their life. Maybe it doesn't have to be this way. That's what the Holy Spirit does. What the church has done is just slam them with the 12 lists and the 10 laws and the do this and the don't do that. And they know that, and all they're saying is get away. Because there's no conviction when it comes to judgment. Conviction comes with no condemnation. Conviction comes when you love somebody that is unlovable. When you just reach out and try to be Christ-like to them in spite of them. Praise the Lord. It's hard to watch people that you care about when they make poor decisions. And then you have to see the consequences that those decisions and those choices make. It breaks your heart if you care about them. But the goal of confrontation isn't to make people feel bad. They already feel bad. They may not admit it, but they already are miserable. So the goal of my confrontation or my interaction with them isn't to get them to feel bad. That's where we have screwed up, telling people, you know, beat them, give them all the sin, how bad you are. Now get up here and repent. That is not repentance, and that's not the confrontation that Jesus brings. We think repentance is feeling bad. Well, if that's the case, then three-fourths of the unsaved world out here has repented. They feel bad, they just can't do anything about it. It isn't to make them feel bad, it's to get them to believe. We want them to believe. We don't want them to feel bad. We want them to believe. We want them to change their mind. That's repentance. This is crazy. I want something better. I want something good. I want some good stuff in my life for a change. That's repentance. I see my choices have been bad. They brought me some bad stuff. But if I choose him, I can escape the consequences of all this, and I can have all the blessings of God. Because God's not mad at me. God's not asking me to be a really good person. God's just asking me to believe. And when we go around trying to act like we're so good, it puts them in this position of, well, I can't be like them. Of course they can. We were just like them. And I'm not saying lifestyles won't change, but that isn't how we gauge a Christian's belief or unbelief. Some people are just not as bright as others. Hey, I'm just being honest. Some people, you know, you can't expect everybody to grow at the same rate. Jesus just loved them. I mean, he wasn't worried about the external, about the outward manifestation in terms of their behavior. He was interested in whether they believed or not. And if you get a person to believe the right way because of God's love, things will change in their life without them having to go through a regimen, without you having to teach them the 10 rules of don't do this and don't do that. It will just, the Holy Spirit will show them. That was a bad choice. Remember that? It wasn't good. It brought a bunch of junk. You don't want that. Right? It isn't about God's going to beat you up. It's about there's consequences, and you don't want them. Now, if you want them, you can have them and still go to heaven. But that's what I mean about not being real bright. So some of us are pretty smart in some areas and not so smart in other areas. We repeat. And the reason for that is our unbelief that God can do something that we can't do, that God can deliver us from that God can do this for us, that God can make this all things new. And because we don't have total confidence in that, we continue to repeat some behaviors. But Jesus isn't judging that. Jesus isn't condemning. He's saying the same way you learn to believe for your salvation, for your quote-unquote not going to hell, was based on my love for you, is the same way you're going to learn to believe that drunkenness and drug addiction is probably not a good lifestyle, or that continuous relationships, in and out of relationships, are not good because you're hurting, they're hurting, and everybody around it is hurting. Not because if you do it, you're going to hell, but because if you do it, you create hell for your own life here. And God wants you to have life in that more abundantly because he loves you so much. It isn't about us giving them the trap that says, I remember some of them that had like 10 things, you know, you do and your life will be perfect. Well, if I'd done those 10 things, I wouldn't need the track. I wouldn't need Jesus. I would have just done it. I would have just made my life good. But my life was a mess because I was a mess. Because I didn't know how to believe. I didn't know what to believe. I believed if I went to God, it was going to be a smackdown. It was going to be, you got this. I knew I had it coming. And if everything that I'd learned from religion was true, then I was in for a real beating. And I didn't want another one. I had enough problems. I had enough issues. So the goal that we have with the help of the Holy Spirit is to help people take ownership of their lives and let God reign. That's exactly what Tim was saying here this morning. We're trying to help them to take ownership for their life. Because then and only then can God reign in their life. I know, you know, from a religious point of view, this is, you know, it's disorienting. It's like spiritual vertigo. You're just going, whoa, wait a minute, this can't be right. It's so not what I've always thought or not what I've always been taught. But it's the truth of God. God's been doing it this way for a long time. It didn't just start with this message this morning. After Adam screwed up and found himself naked, what did God do? Run him down and beat him and then ridicule him for being naked? He clothed him. He clothed him and then gave him a plan for how they would still be redeemed, even though they had gone directly against what God had told them. David, God restores him after he commits adultery and then murders the woman's husband. Praise the Lord. We're talking about Levi, that tax collector. Jesus sat at dinner with this guy, celebrated the man after the guy had been cheating people all that day. That same day, he'd been out there ripping people off, taking advantage of them, stealing from them, hiking their taxes, adding to their taxes, all of this stuff. And Jesus goes and has dinner with the guy. I mean, religiously, you would think, I'm not going anywhere near you until you get your act together and give all those people their money back and straighten your life up and get it together, and then maybe we'll get together on some neutral ground. No. Knowing everything he knew about the guy, he goes right to his house. And you know the result of this was, Jesus never condemned him, never corrected him about what he was doing. The guy knew what he was doing. But without Jesus ever saying a word, all Jesus did was show him he cared, that the guy was important to him. And what does the guy do? Without Jesus ever saying a word, the guy says, I'm giving back 7 times anything I've ever taken from anybody. Jesus didn't give him a rule, didn't give him a you do this or this is going to happen. The guy just on his own took ownership for his screw-ups and said, you know what, I'm going to make this right to the best of my ability. I'm going to give him back 7 times. I'm going to prove to them that I'm not the guy that I've been. Praise the Lord. That's what the Holy Spirit does. What Jesus teaches is helping somebody in a bind because of their own sinfulness, because of their own poor choices, is the best way to create conviction. That's why he says in other places in the Old Testament, love your enemies. It's like heaping coals of fire on them. When you do good for somebody who's created their own mess, they're only getting what they deserve. They're only getting what the consequences of their behavior demands. And you love them, and you reach out to them, and you show compassion, you are representing Christ. You are being like Jesus at that moment. The Holy Spirit is working through you at that point, and conviction will come to them. They'll realize, it's not God's fault this is happening. It's my choice. It's my choice. The answer is to turn to God, to believe in God now. Something good can come out of this. Praise God. Romans chapter 2 and verse 4. You know, somebody said, and we've all heard this many, many times, but the definition of insanity is to keep doing the same thing over and over and over and thinking you're going to get a different result. Well, maybe we need to take another look at what Jesus' life really was about and start emulating that, because the Holy Ghost isn't going to work in our own agenda. He has a plan. He has a purpose. His purpose is to bring us into all truth, to bring the unbeliever into belief, and to bring the believer into complete belief, into total belief, into all truth. Praise God. So, or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. So, you know, instead of telling people, well, you know, the reason you're suffering with this ailment or this addiction or this messed up lifestyle, it's because God's punishing you. Well, what alternative do they have then? But to dive deeper into whatever it is they're already in, because obviously there's no answer outside of this. But if you tell them, look, God loves you. And though you have made some really bad choices, God's here to rescue you. He's here to take you out of this mess. He's here to love you in spite of all the mess. He's not judging you. He's empathetic. He's compassionate. He's reaching out. He's saying, I love you. I don't care you've made a lot of bad choices. Everybody made bad choices. I don't want you to suffer the consequences of those choices for the rest of your life. I've got a better plan. I've got a purpose for your life. I've got something good. Jesus was and is grace and truth. They're synonymous. They're the same thing. The way to the Father embodied. That was Jesus. The way to God in a human body. And he's left us with the same charge to be a way to God right here. Not by how religious I am, not by how much better I am than somebody else, but by my humanity, I can relate to their humanity and allow the Holy Spirit then to do what only the Holy Spirit can do. Show them the love of God in an earthen vessel. Praise God. People ran to Jesus. They couldn't wait to get around him. They weren't afraid of him. They wanted to get to him to repent. They wanted to know that there was some other alternative than the religion that they'd been told about and the lack of relationship with God that they had experienced all of their lives. They wanted to repent and they wanted to have a changed life. In other words, they wanted to believe. They just wanted something that they could believe in. Something that was good to believe in, and not something that if I believe in it, whoa, this is not good. And that's why I have such a problem with all of these Christian shows that are saying, this is the judgment of God, that's the judgment of God, this is the judgment of God, you know, this is coming, here it is. We got, a flood, it's the judgment of God. This is the Twin Tower, it's the judgment of God. No, it's fallen man. It's what we get without God. If it's the judgment of God, then God is a liar. There'll be no more judgment from God until the Holy Spirit, that's us, is taken out of here. Because we bear that presence of the Holy Spirit. Once the Holy Spirit is gone, people are back under the law. They're back under judgment because they have not believed. Not because of what they're doing, but because they haven't believed. I mean, think about it. I don't know what they're going to be doing that's any worse than what we've been doing. Or is it be more murder, more mayhem, more rape, more plunder, more, it'll just be more of it, but it's already here. It's been here all along. He said the Antichrist is with us right now, among us right now, clear back 2,000 years ago. The Spirit was there then. It's still here. But the Holy Spirit restrains it, keeps it from totally dominating. Think what we could do if we cooperated with the Holy Spirit instead of trying to be the Holy Spirit. Praise God. I believe this is revival. I believe this is how revival must come. It's the way it came in the first place when the Holy Spirit fell. People believed. And they were changed by the thousands. Praise God. His Spirit, the Holy Spirit, Christ in you, the hope of glory. It gets revealed. God gets revealed. And that Holy Spirit leads us to do the very same thing. That's what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, helps us, teaches us to know how to be more like Jesus. Not how to be better people, quote unquote. Not how to be moral, not how to be more religious, but how to be like Jesus. No condemnation. Compassion. The first thing that he says about a believer is once you believe, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For those who walk not after the flesh. Well, if we don't have any condemnation, how is it we're able to produce so much of it? People get truly convicted, what God calls conviction, as they encounter God through us. People were convicted in the presence of Jesus without Jesus doing anything but just being there and loving them. Think about the prostitutes, the sinners, the publicans, the tax collectors, all these people. They got convicted. He didn't get up. When he was in their presence, he was preaching to the religious people. It was always the Pharisees he was preaching to. They just happened to be there. And they were griping and complaining about him being with these friends of sinners. He was with these sinners all the time. And so the rabbis and the religious people were constantly condemning him for that. And so then he would tell them a parable about the prodigal son and the one that stayed home that was judging and criticizing, and the poor doofus that was off blowing everything and screwing his whole life up comes back, and God comes running to him and hugs him and loves him and everything else. And the religious bigot over here who doesn't want to even be called his brother, and God says to him, look, you had access to this same grace all the time. It's been available for you too, just like it has been him. But you're so busy out here working, trying to make yourself acceptable, that now you're not only have you made yourself unable to receive the good things that God has for you, but you're going to condemn everybody else that wants it or that's willing to receive it. Praise God. 1 John chapter 2, verse 6. One more scripture after this, and we'll quit. Hallelujah. 1 John 2 and 6. He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also to walk even as he walked. So if we're one with Jesus, we ought to be trying to figure out how did Jesus do it and do it that way and quit trying to do it religiously. If you think about this, this not only do you set people free, you get free. You don't have to feel like I got to weigh and balance this person against that person and this. You know, and come on, because we got a lot of grace for our own family. Right? I mean, we all have kids. I mean, my mother, thank God, she, you know, prayed and believed God for me in spite of me. I don't know that she would have done it for the kid down the street, because she probably would have figured he's just a jerk. He's just a troublemaker. You know how it is. It's always somebody else's kids that get your kids into trouble. My kids wouldn't do that. They just got in with the wrong crowd. Well, hey, they're part of the crowd. Hallelujah. So I'm just saying, we do it innately for people that we love. We are gracious to them. We are long-suffering with them. And God is saying, if you can do that for your children, how much more do I do it who is perfect for all of my children, for everybody? Praise the Lord. So he that saith he abideth in him ought also to walk even as he walked. Now, he's not talking about walking without ever having sins in your life, but to walk in that compassion and in that grace and in that love and no condemnation that Jesus walked in. Galatians 5:19, we'll quit. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm so glad he's this way, because I'll tell you, it's awful frustrating trying to be perfect. Hallelujah. My little, it's just tough. My little children, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you. Now, this is beyond conversion. This is transformation. Christ in you, the hope of glory. That is the Holy Spirit leading and guiding us into all truth, into all that Jesus has done, in all that Jesus is. I want that. I want, before I leave this planet, I want it said of me that he believed God. Not just that I wouldn't go to hell, but I believed God when sickness came. I believed God when death came knocking. I believed God when finances were all screwed up. I believed God when my relationships were all scattered and in disarray. I believed God for whatever the circumstance, that he would be greater and that he would be on my side to bless me. That's coming into the full stature of Jesus Christ, because Jesus believed God. He only said what his Father said. He only did what he saw his Father do. Amen? And that's what the Holy Spirit has come here to teach us, all truth, so that we can believe everywhere. If that's the case, then we are the perfect candidates to help those who don't believe, teach them how to believe. Right? I'm believing for a healing. They're believing or trying to believe that God is real, that God does love them, that God does care for them. I can help them because I had to learn how to believe some things. I'm still learning how to believe things. So I can be compassionate. I can be long-suffering. I can be non-judgmental because I know it's not easy when your life is a total disaster to think that God is going to care. I can't tell you how many times I prayed the sinner's prayer. And to be quite honest with you, I know when I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, but I don't know when I got saved. I might have been 12, 14 years old crying out because of frustration and family and all kinds of other things and just wanting something to be real, but never had a quote-unquote epiphany. I mean, I never had any grand evidence of it, but that doesn't mean God hadn't moved. I wanted to believe. I wanted to believe what they told me in Sunday school was true, that Jesus is standing at the door knocking, that he does love the little children, that he does care. But there was other messages coming too, that not if you're acting up. So I get on my daughter about telling her, my granddaughter, that Santa's not going to give her this stuff because she's been naughty. Well, she's been naughty. But I know Santa's still going to give her the stuff. Right? I think it sends messages that cause our kids to distrust. If you're going to have a Santa Claus, I'm not against Santa Claus, but if you're going to have him, make him a benevolent Santa Claus. He's not packing coal in the sack. He's got nothing but good stuff for the kids. He's not making a list of the naughty and the nice. He only knows the nice. Amen? If he's the epitome of God coming and bearing gifts, our Father of lights, with whom there's no variableness, every good and perfect gift comes from him. There's no coal coming from God. God's not going to slap us down and say, no Christmas for you this year because the naughty outweighed the nice. It always does. But God just keeps pouring out his gifts. And so should Santa. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Okay, let me pray real quick for the food, and that way you can get down there and get right into line, and I hope everybody will stay and enjoy what's been prepared. Father, we thank you for the provision, and thank you for the hands that have prepared it. We ask you to bless it now to the nourishment of our bodies. Bless this time of fellowship, and let us experience your presence and your love as we share our lives with one another within this body and outside the walls of this church. Holy Spirit, do what only you can do. Love them through us. Show your compassion. Show your goodness. Save the lost. Heal the sick. Raise the dead. Cast out demons. Do what only the Holy Spirit can do, but only will do through us. So again, Lord, we thank you for the food today. Bless it, and we appreciate all that you do for us. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Enjoy the lunch. Hallelujah. There's plenty there. If you came and weren't aware that we were having it, don't